And yes, I give you permission to record me.
Thank you.
Thank you for listening.
I appreciate that.
Yes. So, it was a the meeting in the morning when we were having a online conference call, marking the moment of when the great Mount St. Helens eruption occurred.
Mm-hmm.
At around 8:32 a.m. Although the time I think actually was probably closer to 8:31. It kind of depends upon when you think the eruption occurs because of the earthquake on the beginning of the seismic stuff. But nonetheless, it was a very significant event. I was fortunate to have been going to college at Linfield College, which was about 90 kilometers southwest of Mount St. Helens. So Mount St. Helens was actually right in our backyard. And I remember in March when the first significant ash eruption occurred. There had been steam events prior to that, but the first ash eruption occurred. It occurred on what was in a physics midterm final day, and midterms were canceled to then go to the mountain and collect data. The professor who also did a lot of work in geology wasn't going to waste time on a midterm when a volcano was it had steam explosion, but this is the first time that there was a significant ash event, right? Where the mountain, which had was known for being relatively symmetrical. It was like a symmetrical bell curve.
Mm-hmm.
And you could see the dusting of ash from the ejection had occurred. There had been a number of earthquakes that were rising up in the mountain from down below. And so this was, it was active. You know, it was an active volcano. It still is an active volcano, but it was becoming more and more active, and there were steam events occurring because it had glaciers on top of it, and water was seeping down into the ground table, and you were getting steam explosions that were resulting in superheated water coming out.
Mm-hmm.
So the seeped water would under pressure rise to the point where it boiled, and then you get this push up the top. But the thing that occurred, I believe it was on March 27th, if I recall, was there was a significant ash event where it was more than simply water contacting hot rock, but that we saw evidence that magma was working its way towards the surface. So the ashes and the gases there sort of confirm that. And so the monitoring of the mountain became quite intensive at the time. Even at the same time that the officials, because it was under a volcano warning for quite some time, and they're trying to limit the number of people going into the forestry area. It was a forestry region, and they're trying to limit that again because of the danger. But when it started doing the ash explosions, and you can see the epicenters moving up inside the mountain, it was pretty obvious that some event was coming forward. But it wasn't until late April that we started seeing that this is more than simply just be some lava coming out and dribbling down the sides, that it was going to be a potentially bigger event. The thing that at the time was that this was pre-GPS, so we didn't have the kind of tilt meter electronics and positional electronics that we do now on the Kilauea volcano.
Mm-hmm.
Kilauea and Mauna Loa being probably the two most well-monitored volcanoes in the world.
Sure.
So as a college student, I had grown up with Mount Lassen. We'd also gone to Yellowstone, right, and seen the Yellowstone Geyser Basin. I wasn't as impressed with Yellowstone because it was an old, it was things that the last, then the last eruptions in the Yellowstone Basin were like 15,000 years ago, and it was old geologically speaking, and had done its thing a long, long time ago. Whereas Mount Lassen was relatively fresh. So the monitoring of the Cascade volcanoes was something that was done to some level. And at the time, even in 1979, when I started going to college at Linfield, the bets were on Mount Baker as being the most active or the most likely to erupt next.
Mm-hmm.
And Mount St. Helens coming into the play and jumping in ahead was actually a surprise to a number of people. And in fact, if you look at its position along the Cascades, it's actually somewhat to the west of the Cascade line. When you go up through, you know, things like Mount Hood, Mount Shasta, Mount Lassen, Mount Baker, Mount Rainier. It was sort of the side of it, but it was not necessarily erupting. That, of course, taught us a little bit more about what the material is like and what the continental issues are like below it. So we learned a lot. But at the time when Mount Helens was erupting, it was like, wow, you know, that's kind of surprising. It's the one to go, and in our lifetime. So naturally, when it first started having the ash explosions, that was a big event, and that's what caused the physics midterm. It's like, we have more important things to do than to test you on stuff. Here's geophysics in action. And so going up there, getting out samples, and trying to understand what the volcano was doing was quite critical. Now,
I'm surprised they didn't give you any equations to solve based on the eruption.
Well, we were doing equations ourselves. I mean, we were estimating the amount of ash that came out. We were trying to do gas measurements to try to determine materials coming out there. And again, it had been seismic active leading up to the March event that started. It had been fairly seismic active, and so, I mean, it was March 27th when the first ash events.
Mm-hmm.
And again, there's a difference between having steam rising out of it and erupting. For example, in Mount Rainier, you can go up to the summit if you're a really good climber, and you can go inside the top crater vent, and you can feel you can see steam and feel the heat coming from the central vent at Mount Rainier. Mount Lassen, even at the time in the 1970s, you could see areas where it had been covered, colored by the sulfur stuff coming out.
Mm-hmm.
But again, having ash eruptions was actually quite significant. That was telling us that the magmatic gases were reaching boiling point. Magma is liquid rock, right? And liquid rock is just as heavy, just as sluggish as real rock. And so it would refer to sink down, but it rises. Its buoyancy comes from the fact that inside magma are a number of dissolved gases under such tremendous pressure, they're liquefied. But as magma reaches goes towards the surface, the pressure drops. As the pressure drops, you can get gases that begin to boil out of solution, come out of solution and boil. And that boiling helps give the magma loft and so forth. And the gases, if the gases work to the point where you get to cracks in the rock, those gases, those magmatic gases, can start to escape. So when you sample the gases at a vent of an erupting volcano, you look for very trace gases. That tells you what's boiling, and it tells you at what level they're boiling. And then you can correlate with earthquakes, looking at depth to try to determine, okay, we've got some earthquakes. What's the earthquakes from? Well, in addition to rock cracking, it's the bubbles popping inside and the magma pours it up. So normally in a place like Yellowstone, a place like Bumas Hill in Lassen, you have really water reaching down to hot rocks, boiling and coming up, geysers and so forth.
So what's the time we're looking at? Because you're going a little faster than I think I can process a little bit. No, it's okay. But you know me. I like to ask questions when they come up because otherwise I forget.
Please, please interrupt me.
So you're talking about this kind of gas to liquid to gas to this kind of exchange that's going on. But what is the time? What's the time duration that we're talking about? So when the bubbles come up and the gas goes into a liquid that then boils, what are we talking about? Are we talking about seconds, minutes, hours? Or is it kind of like the Conway's Game of Life where things start up and then die off and then start up again and then die off and
It's actually more complex cycling of stuff.
uh-huh.
I remember that in magma deep down in the earth still has dissolved gases in it. It's all being that the gases are under pressure in your liquid form. And so, but because it's under such tremendous pressure, the gas is forced to actually liquid form. And so it's not, they're not bubbles until the magma, until the pressure drops. Why does the pressure drop? Because as the magma works its way towards the surface, that the buoyancy from those gases, it reaches a point where the pressure drops low enough that the gases re a gas reaches its boiling point.
And I'm having,
You
I'm just having issues with the sense of scale, right? Because we're really talking about enormous amounts of volume happening
Yes,
all at once,
enormous
like
pressure.
city blocks doing this in very quick
Yes,
succession.
and so there's also a complex process because what will happen at the top of a plume. So imagine a plume is rising up, and a plume, these magma chambers can be on you know in the, on the surface of things can be like kilometers or two in diameter, right? Can be large sets, but as it works its way to the top, or working its way to lower and lower pressures, at some point the pressure is such that liquefied gas turns into vapor. You get a bubble pop, right? When that bubble pops, you can see from seismic, you can see the seismic evidence of that, because you get what they call harmonic tremors. Why are there harmonic tremors? Well, the bubble pops, it puts pressure on the surrounding areas, which causes that gas to go back in solution. And then furthermore, the magma will surge up into the bubble and collapse the gas back into liquid form. And so you get this pop, 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 pop back and forth, much like you see on the bottom of a boiling pot, water that's a pot of water come to boil. You'll see the bubbles start to form, vapor bubbles start to form on the bottom, where it's hot, and they'll come back in. Now, that action also will allow the gas to work its way up through cracks in the rock. In fact, that those popping bubbles will help crack the rock. And so you might have cases where over time, the period of time that it might go depends on how far the magma chamber is below it, but it can take hours to days for that gas to rise up through if it's a very deep system. Also, another thing that's complicated with the fact is that magma tends to pool in chambers. So at Mount St. Helens, below Mount St. Helens, probably about if you know, the mountain, if the mountain's like this, you're talking about a chamber that's below the volcano, perhaps as deep below the ground level as it is tall. Was where and that magma chamber was fed by a lower magma chamber, an even lower magma chamber. So they typically these mountains have several of these magma chambers in succession with pipes or vent paths that go up into it. And deep down in the ground, in the case of the Cascades, you have the North American plate rubbing up against oceanic plates, and that friction is what's generating heat. That energy goes up into a magma chamber, which causes it to, and it gives it a fresh surge of dissolved gases, which gives it buoyancy, causes it to work its way up into the next chamber. So you have like this double boiler, if you will. And as long as the chamber's having energy fed into it, we call the volcano active. When the chambers begin to lose energy, we call it dormant. And when the chamber freezes over, even though it might be plastic in its thing, then it goes to the from the dormant to the extinct. So in the case of Mount Helens, what happened was that the friction of the continents below it had worked enough gases over centuries to come up into the lower chamber, which then sent material through cracks and pipes up to the upper magma chamber. And that added pressure caused it to push up and begin to push its way up through the rock, again, due to the pressure. At the top of that pressure, on top of that, of those pushes, is where the pressure would drop low enough that the gas would go from things like carbon dioxide, and water and hydrogen sulfide and other sort of stuff. That when they reach the point where they can no longer be liquid, they turn to vapor. This pop. And that bubble pop will cause it to push against the stuff and liquefy the stuff near it. And then the magma will push up against it and repressurize it. Moreover, so you get to sort of bubble popping at the top. The next thing that happens is that magma gets to be what's called stale, right? It loses because the gases that sometimes it can work up through the rock, up through cracks towards the surface. Now, usually what they do with those gases are hot, and usually what it does is it encounters the water table. And the water table causes steam, and steam is a really good, there's plenty of steam down in the lower rocks, and that's where you get the big surge. You get the, but when you start to get magmatic gases associated with it, you get the boom with a little bit of dust, a little bit of other gases besides purely just superheated steam.
Did you say magnetic gases?
Magmatic,
Oh,
magmatic,
magmatic. I was like, well, that
magmatic
was going to
gases.
blow my mind if that was.
Now, it turns out the magnetic field actually prints itself in the hardening of the magma. But the you have the gases coming up, but when those gases escape, then the top of that magma chamber becomes what we call stale. It loses its buoyancy, and so it sinks in. It begins to fall in, and the fresher magma below it will actually replace it. So it actually turns over. It actually will the magma chamber will actually turn over because the top and the top loses buoyancy. It falls in, and the fresher magma comes back up. So now you get what we call a turnover of the magma chamber. Turnover puts new magma up near the top that has gases that come out of solution and force its way through. And so you get this turnover effect. We've learned from bringing from Kilauea that you can see evidence of this magma chamber turning over because of the tilt meter. If you put very accurate tilt meters on the ground, you can see the ground heaving, doing this breathing motion. And what happens is that, and you can see a tilt meter. In fact, you can see this in Kilauea's tilt meter. These magma cycling, they call it deflation inflation events. The mountain deflates. Why? Because the gas at the top of the chamber has gone into vapor form, works its way through the cracks, it becomes stale, it sinks in, so the mountain kind of sinks in, and the new more buoyant magma chamber works its way through, it turns over. Magma that's more buoyant reaches the top, and now the mountain expands. And then the gases come up solution and the magma. We have this deflation inflation cycle, and you can see that in the Kilauea tilt meters. That's evidence of the mountain being active. The rate at which it turns over is a function of how much energy is coming in from below, how much material is coming in below. And so we didn't have the detailed tilt meters and instrumentation in the 1980s there that we do now. But imagine if we had the Kilauea tilt meters, we'd have seen the mountain breathing, we've seen the mountain cycling. And in fact, as the mountain cycles faster and faster and faster, that tells you there's more and more material coming in. If it's stopped erupting, you'll get the last turnover, nothing will resurge in, and it'll sit there and quiver and cool. So the March 27th event was the first time that there's enough gases coming close to the surface that in addition to steam explosion, you start seeing gases from the actual magma and carrying bits of ash with it. And so you'll see those early things with the dusting at the top of the vent that had steam explosions before, now showing dust, now showing evidence that magma's working itself through. Plus, you can see the epicenters working the way up, higher and higher and higher in the mountain. So this thing of the ash explosions of March or late March told us that an eruption was heading our way.
Mm-hmm.
Not really just a bunch of steam explosions.
But something big.
Something more significant than just simply a bunch of steam explosions.
So how many times did you start going? You obviously didn't just go on the 18th, right? You've been going before then up until the 18th, yes?
Well, I mean, we started on March 27th was the first ash event.
Right, and then
we started going back up there.
Okay.
Now we were trying to understand what was happening to the mountain. Also, at the time, instrumentation telemetry was very limited. We didn't have the Internet of Things out there. We didn't have GPSs. We didn't have these long-range microelectronics type of thing. We had to do something more crude. And the way that we were beginning to monitor, trying to understand what the mountain was doing in size and shade and shape, was with corner reflectors. Literally, those triangles that they stick when a truck is inside the road broken down and puts those red triangles with the retro reflectors
right
behind it. That's what we use. We there was at McMinnville, Oregon, where Linville College, there was a aviation company called Evergreen Helicopters. And Evergreen has that interesting history of a lot of things, but in one particular was there. You know, they have pilots that are both very safe and have no fear, and which was going to come in very, very handy later on. But they were the ones willing to go up and, you know, we took helicopters from the McMinnville airfield up to Mount St. Helens and just took quad reflectors and threw them out the window, right? Landed on the ground. Now, what were we using that for? Well, we would then come in the Forest Service land and use lasers and bounce laser beams, try to find one of those things in binoculars or a telescope, yep, find one of them, and then shoot a laser beam off of it, and get and knowing the speed of light, we would then get a distance from a known spot, bearing marker, up to this spot on the side of the mountain. And that's, again, our thing of trying to understand, is the mountain changing shape? Because presumably, if there's ash coming out, it's because the magma's moving up. The epicenters are getting higher and higher, so we expect to see the mountain changing shape.
Sure.
And so that was kind of the crude way of doing it, because, you know, nowadays you drop GPS meters and you have other fancy stuff, but we're talking about 1980 technology.
Is that how we knew that it was going to happen on the north side of the mountain, as opposed to could have gone anywhere?
Yes.
Okay. Basically these reflectors were showing more movement on the north side. I guess it's the northwest side, I guess.
Northeast. North and northwest, it kind of depends on, I mean, it's kind of like north-northwest. But
right.
But there was, so we had that thing. We also had, NASA had U-2 planes with infrared sensors that were doing other things at the time, but we convinced them to...
let you borrow them?
convinced them that while they were heading north, and I'd say... they're not necessarily NASA, they're actually Air Force, I should say, correct about that. But NASA was our liaison with Air Force, saying, while you're heading north to do infrared stuff for those people way, way over the other side, why don't you just take pictures of Mount St. Helens area to see if we can see thermal signatures?
Mm-hmm.
And so they did, and we could see the thermal hotspot at the beginning near the vent where the top of the vent, because of steam explosions, the vent was actually widening, but we could also see that the thermal signatures of the result of just this, not surprising, hot gas that was heating up the rocks. But things began to change in late April, and in particular a couple things happened. The hot spot moved from the very top where the steam explosion was down and a new spot down on the side, an area called Goat Rocks, was becoming more prevalent.
Goat Rocks?
That causes Goat Rocks.
Uh-huh.
Goat Rocks is a spot that is on the, on the mountain, but it was on the side that was, it's on sort of the north northwest side of the thing. It was probably one of the spots you could say that the nice symmetrical bell curve has kind of had a little bit of discontinuity. And those of the when we saw that Goat's Rocks was becoming warmer from, again, these U-2 spy planes doing us a favor and taking pictures of the mountain going over with very sensitive infrared cameras, that turned our attention from the very top over to the side. And so we put color reflectors around Goat's Rock to begin to measure the Goat's Rock area. And that's where we got quite surprised. We were started seeing and I think it was like in like April 25th or so, if I recall correctly, one of our measurements showed that the mountain was expanding at a rate of around 1 meter or 3 feet a day.
Okay.
That the thing was in size.
This was in April,
Also,
right?
yeah, there's also what happened was that the mountain went quiet as far as steam explosions. We had one nice burst and then it stopped. And this created kind of a problem because, we've had these rumblings and earthquakes and steam stuff. The area had been kind of closed off for months. We had people that were happened to be having cabins there, warnings saying, anytime we could ask you to leave, be sure even shelters are in place. We don't know what's happening, but something's happening. And trying to keep the people out, tourists out of the area, so that the people, if there was a problem, could evacuate. And it was also kind of the case where there were people who preferred to be left alone, and other people that wanted to do logging. And when the mountain stopped its steam puffs,
They
they
thought it
didn't
was
say,
over.
okay. And they say, okay, everything's fine, let's go back in. None of this stay at home stuff, stay away stuff. We got work to do. We got lives to deal with it, and we're going like, well, but no, it's actually more dangerous.
It's the calm before the storm.
And it's the pressure building up. And particularly when we saw the Goat Rocks expanding. Now the determination now, we didn't quite know, but the determination now is that what happened is that the main part of the magma had worked its way up in worked up and contacted the base of the plug. Well, my islands had a lot of these flows from previous eruptions where lava went up to the top and spilled out the side and made this sort of nice a bell curve sort of thing. The central vent of Mountain Helens was a solid rock floor. And the magma had the lower magma, the highest magma chamber, I worked it up to the base of the plug. The plug was actually thermally fairly good heat sink. And so what happened was that the magma, when it reached the bottom of the plug, froze. It froze solid. And back to the magma started, when it started to work its way into the rock, froze solid and basically jammed the vent pipes, jammed the ability of pressure to work us out through the cracks in the central plug of the volcano.
Is this where the concepts of domes and super domes come from?
Yes.
Where that.
And
Oh, go ahead.
please go ahead.
Oh, no, I just remember, reading up on, what happened, and this is kind of filling in a lot of the blanks. And I've got more questions about stuff that we've talked about so far, but it makes a lot of sense that, that these domes that would then, reform elsewhere when a plug forms, right? And so I remember them saying that there was the normal dome of the magma, and then a super dome formed underneath that, which is what then, redirected the pressure even more towards the side.
Because the upper magma chamber had risen up high enough that now you had some of the more common magmatic gases
How much movement are we talking about? When you
coming.
say when it raised, rose high enough, how high does it have to raise to be enough?
I think that by that time it had moved up almost a kilometer inside the mountain.
Over how much time?
And it,
About like 2 or 3 weeks?
over several months.
Oh, several months. Okay.
Yep. And as well that the gases were evidence. We could tell what was boiling by sampling gases. And you do that by helicopter flights and just in the plume when it wasn't going ash steam.
Right.
Again, the Evergreen helicopter pilot had no fear of that sort of
That's
stuff.
impressive. Were they bush pilots in another life?
Yeah, they were also were, and they did extents in Vietnam and Laos and Cambodia, and
Got it.
they sort of said, "It's just shooting at us, but
We're used to
get
it.
ready now."
Okay.
But yes, but actually, when the protocol was that you would see the beginnings of the boiling of the bubbles popping, because you could see you can you the side of the cars would pick up the harmonic tremor, and at some point you get the whoosh out. Release pressure, and after the whoosh is done, and ash settles, that's when you go in,
Right.
because that's when the pressure is low enough, and that's when you go in to sample things and get back out.
How much time do you have, sort of a safe time to go in and do that? I mean, do you have like a couple hours or is it a couple days? I mean, or do you have to do
Yeah,
it right
a
away?
couple hours. I mean, I think that the time we were seeing, when it got really active, we're seeing ash explosions maybe every 6 to 8 hours.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so you'd have the thing settle, and you say, okay, it's quiet, it's done its thing. Let's go in now, grab gas samples, and it's a simple matter of having helicopter with a you lower down a little a tube that scoop air. It. We also you get little grabbers that go down and do touch contact on the top of the of let's say the ice snow up there and pick up material, so you can bring that back for analysis.
Reminds me of
So
those arcade games where the claw comes down and
yes. And again, and you wouldn't want to necessarily sit over the actual bit. So you want to look down into the cannon. That was not something
Not a wise
that
idea.
not advised.
But you did say something earlier that I don't want to forget. You said that we now know that the magma chamber had changed elevation enough. How did we come to find out that that's what happened after the fact? What kind of evidence did we have to say, okay, this magma chamber shifted and therefore we know that this has happened? I mean, with that kind of destruction, how do you
Well,
find that out?
with the May 18th eruption and the films and photos, we can see the mountain basically tearing itself open. So in that sense, we can see the size of stuff and size of stuff, and then you can build the models that are there. But as I say, we're getting ahead of ourselves.
Oh, sorry.
The thing that happened when the mountain went quiet, and for several weeks, was that there was tremendous pressure building up inside the mountain, but it had no way to go. And so instead of coming out the top through cracks in the plug, because now the magma we know now had worked its way up, started into the plug, had frozen solid and sealed it off, is that the pressure worked its way to the side. And go box was one of those things down on the side where it began to expand out. So the mountain, the magmatic pressure had to come go somewhere, and remember, it had risen high enough that would have been dissolved gases were now coming out in vapor form, and exerting tremendous pressure. Now, had we had the kind of peculiar-like instruments at the top, we would have seen the tilt meters go crazy. We were seeing the gas samples showing trace minerals, right, of stuff and trace mineral gases coming out that would have told us what happened, but we didn't have that kind of detail at the time. So what we saw was first the signature was the U2 planes with the sensor camera film was showing that a new hotspot had shown up. The hotspot was to the north-northwest down the side, by the mountain, that the top had sort of was cooling down, and this was the hot spot, right? And again, we're talking about a few degrees, but over a side of the mountain, significant energy. So that's what we took and dropped quarter reflectors around those rocks and measured it. And that's when we saw that the mountain was moving. And again, the ground was pushing up at a rate at that time in mid to late April was pushing up at about 1 meter, about 3 feet a day, right, before it, right? And the top was not bulging that much. The top was relatively stable. The top had stopped expanding, and it was the side that began to bulge, and bulge fast, right? Mountains don't grow that fast.
Yeah, yeah.
That's something happening. So that's when he said, that's when that, and it was fortunate we had those infrared signatures, because we might have not have seen that spot. And so the gross rocks began to deform faster and faster and faster. The final time or the readings I believe were May 14th, because May 14th, May 15th was another dramatic spot where again we had enough core reflectors on the gross rocks that there was no overflights, right? There was no ash ejections coming up the top, so there was no need for helicopter flights. It was drive around through places like Clearwater, up into the forestry area, and then get to a bearing spot where you do the laser beam bounce, mm-hmm. and try to change there. And it's not that hard, in terms of light goes 300 millimeters a second, so you had basically, 3 nanoseconds change was enough to see that, per day.
Mm-hmm.
So you get precision at that time down to, a hand's width of size, and the thing was growing fast. By the time of the May 14th to 15th information, it was moving then at a rate of around 2 meters an hour, around 6 feet an hour.
Yeah, I remember reading that.
Gone from 1 meter a day to 6 feet an hour. I mean, it was just thing. And in fact, I remember when we took the measurements and we said, that can't be right. Let's try it again. And we saw it change. Try it again. And it would bounce it back and forth, do the calibration thing. It would take you about 10 minutes. You do it again, and each time it was more.
Right.
And more. We saw this line and said, holy bubble. And that's when we said,
we got to get away from here.
We cannot be here. Now, we had as our model the Mount Lassen,
uh-huh.
Great Hot Blast of 1915. And again, at a similar cascade volcano that had a bulge on its side and had this blast come out the side that was fairly significant. And given where it was in the corner, given the hot spot, given the growth of the expanded mountain, we said, that's the danger zone. We had additional pressure on the side, which was all these people who wanted to live in the area, wanted to recreate in the area, wanted to go to Spirit Lake, and May it was going to be nice summer weather, and what are these evil government people telling us what to do, da da da, and telling the shelter in place and so forth, and it's like the mountain stops, so we know that people are going around the roadblocks, right? The mountain people knew the passes, and so you put us a box to keep the tourists away.
Yeah.
We knew the mountain, we're going to go in there anyway. And, okay. They made their choice and so forth. The thing that was the dramatic throwdown was at Clearwater, there was a scientist, a geologist that was with, I think it was USGS, and several people were there, and we went there to show them this data. And he was like, yeah, we are college students, we'll let the real scientists check it out there. But I said, you can do the same thing, because he actually didn't know where our corner reflectors were, but we showed him where the corner reflectors were. And said, you can do right now and do the changes and see this thing moving. And there were several people there all people but one said, "You're right. This is not good. We should go. You know, some music school, so we should go back and report on this." Other people said, "Yeah, this is not a safe place to be." Now, you know, the argument the guy who stayed there was, "Well, but I'm you know I'm behind the lake," and we said, "Well, no. What we think would happen, unlike in Lapland, if you get a lahar, because look, this is the case of what we thought was if you got lava hitting the bottom of the glacier, if it's super melt under pressure, the water works its way to the bottom of the glacier and comes out in a big rush. You get this lava, rock, mud, blast coming out the bottom of the glacier,
So the
and
previous one didn't have a glacier on it?
well, they had, you know, there was snow. It was covered in snow. There were glacial spots there, and it did produce lahars as we had feared. But our argument was that if it has a Laffan-like blast, the lahar is the least of your worries. But we said the lahar is going to come down the side, it's going to hit Spirit Lake, and go across Spirit Lake as if it's not there. Is it that the Spirit Lake is going to basically give it a steam cushion, and it'll ride across Spirit Lake to the other side. And being on the other side of the lake was just as effective as being right there next to it.
Like a hockey puck going across an ice rink.
Yes. But again, his comment was, "Well, yeah, you hear that most of his colleagues left, but this one guy said, yes, but you know, I need to be here. I want to be here to monitor the instruments. I want to get a first-hand account. You know, yes, you'd be right. You're probably right that might where it blow, but I think I'm back enough and decide I'm going to take a risk because I want to collect the data." And said, "Well, but you can leave your instruments behind, right? You
Was
can leave your instruments behind."
this the guy that was on in the video, the USGS video?
Yeah, one of the people, yes.
Okay.
And it's a sensitive thing because the there's some USGS people that like to get the mythology going and not the some of the more factual stuff.
Sure.
In this case, his thing was, "Well, I want to be here to collect the data, get a first-hand account to be able to publish first." And I remember my advisor saying to him, "You're not going to publish. You're going to die." And that was the last of his book. I mean, we got several people to leave, but this guy was just insistent on staying there. And you know, he did radio the thing of Columbia, you know, this is it. And no radio contact. Given the speed that it came out, it was a very, very, very short time between when the earthquake happened and when he was overcome. And then probably was killed, you know, killed instantly. But I should say that prior to that, we had also gone in the case where we landed near the helicopter near Spirit Lake for a stop, because the pilots have a rest stop before going forward. And I remember we were there. There was a cabin in sort of this cabin inn, this old guy. And he was known to be, you know, he's known to be kind of one of the man of the mountains that have been there for all this. But unfortunately, by that time, he had gotten to be quite paranoid. I think he was worried that people were going to take him to a rest home. I think his children or relatives tried to convince him to leave, and he sort of, you know, push the thing, you know, the mountains. Done this before, you know. I'm going to stay here and enjoy it, blah blah blah. And you're not going to get me out of this thing in a restaurant. So when we showed up, a helicopter and so forth, he thought this was it. Government's going to come and take me away. And he loaded up his shotgun with rock salt and started shooting at us.
Well, thank God it was rock
This son
salt.
of
I mean, that's bad enough, but
and you know and particularly, you know, the pilot sort of said, yeah, you know, I've been shot at before, but I don't like to ride in a helicopter if it has potential damage or who knows what's there. We wouldn't know. So we actually skedaddled out of there. But it's one of the. Go ahead.
I remember in the 80s. So the thing is that I at the, let's see, in 1980, I lived in Maryland. And so I was about as far, almost as far away on the other side of the country as you can possibly get. And I remember watching not too many years later, I think there was a documentary on Mount St. Helens that was filmed. It was not a documentary, it was a docu-feature, you know, one of these mini movie kind of things, you know, mini series. And they had the guy that you're talking about, or at least somebody just like him. And I seem to recall, now maybe this just be, you know, several years of you know, imagination brewing, but I could have sworn that was all part of that particular miniseries with that guy with the rock salt and the shotgun as people try to finally get him off the mountain and he refused to go.
Yeah, I'm told by people who knew him before, you know, months before people kind of tell us that he was friendly, but kind of they said kind of crotchety, right? He
Sure.
would tell tales. It was that, you know, if you could stay at his inn, he'd regale you with tales of trappers and lore and some past. A little bit of cranky, but you know, he was sort of his thing. But as more and more people apparently tried to convince him that it wasn't safe. You know, people just gave up, and we scared a little there. I mean, we were going to have a thing where we say, okay, we'll have lunch here, blah blah blah, and it's like, no, the innkeeper's shooting, you know, the cabin guy is shooting rocks out of this, you know,
Yeah,
kindly.
consider that a response to your bad review.
Yeah, and I say today because they know again, you know, I think somewhat sensitive to the to some of the heirs, but I what I say is I feel sorry for his cats.
Yeah.
Well, he's had lots of cats, and I feel sorry for the cats. They didn't have a choice. But the case of the geologist who knew better, but it's just again the mythology that he was just I would say, well, he was there bravely and it was more than expected, and they tried to do this narrative, oh, no one could have predicted blah 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 blah. Oh yes, there were people that were predicting, and in fact, a bunch of people that said, "Yeah, you're right," and took off. Right? It was a sad thing, and it makes me sort of sad that this what could have been a relatively safe event became a bit of human tragedy. Not only is it the largest landslide in recorded, or the largest landslide in recorded history, but it also was a significant loss of life in you know for the U.S. So we cleared out of the area in the north side on May 15th. Remember, it was my mother's birthday at the time, and so I could remember calling her and wishing her happy birthday, and we went to the southwest for some reason. We chose a spot to the southwest because we could be seismically, you know, still seismically near the volcano. There was actually a sort of a pair of ridges that were behind us. We looked at where the Lahar valleys had been in past, you know, for past eruptions. Took a peak area and had a shield, so we were sort of behind. We were a couple of kilometers from the base of it. We also went to the southwest because the jet stream at the time was carrying material to the northeast, so we were upstream from the jet stream, and we were behind a ridge. We weren't where we were camped. We didn't have visible sight of the mountain, but we could go up to the ridge, take measurements, and come back down. But again, I want to emphasize that the emphasis of safety. That was one of the things that was taught to me, is that volcanoes are dangerous, and unless you understand what's going on, and even then, you don't always know. You need to be in precautions. You had your had, we had escape paths. We had people knew where we were. We had ability. Now, had we stayed up at the water area, I think the question is, would we have been survived? Well, what we know now from what happened is likely no. I mean, there's only so much that heat resistances and gas masks can do. Probably some of the people that were overcome much farther back from the dust and not being able to breathe, right? But there are people that literally choked to death on dust, suffocated on dust, right? They probably could have been saved with gas masks. Some of the people that had the burning stuff, but again, it's kind of a kind of agrees, though, because when... So let's go to the actual event today, the event of
sure.
this 40 years ago. It started with a magnitude 5 earthquake, something you could feel, right? It was a significant earthquake. And the earthquake was in part because the pressure at Goat Rocks area had gotten so much that the mountain began to crack.
Mm-hmm.
And the result was that the mountain, if it was just pressure, right, it had a full landslide and part of the mountain given way going to the north and northwest. But the problem was that underneath that sliding spot with the pressure was a magma chamber. And the magma chamber had in it, magma, that's lava that hadn't reached the surface, with lots of dissolved gases. And so when the thing began, if you look at the movie like of the plane was flying by,
mm-hmm.
You'll see at the very beginning, the bottom being give way and stuff coming out the bottom. That was the earthquake having, the thing on the slide had slipped out, slipped down, broke off, and now the pressure just basically launched that side of the mountain outward. And of course, as the side of the mountain went outward, the pressure dropped dramatically, and everything that was dissolved gas went vaporized at one time. And so the blast started out at the bottom of the mountain. This undercut the top of the mountain. The plug that was sitting at the top,
yeah,
was supported by the side, and you had half of the or a third of the side that was pulled away. Now this plug is sitting there, and gravity is what? Gravity causes the plug
to fall. Down. Yeah.
So the plug falls into the magma chamber, and the magma chamber goes whoosh out, right? So instead of having a nice long multi-month lava streams and whatnot, all of a sudden this magma just gets exposed to the air. And exposed to the air without pressure, and that's when the ash pile goes off and the super gas comes out. I mean, the we measured there the initial earthquake and the undercutting had stuff shoot out at around 350 kilometers an hour if we measured. But by the time the magma the plug had started plunging the magma chamber and splashing it out, the speed at which and it hit Spirit Lake, it was now going at around 1,000 kilometers an hour.
Seriously,
near to see the speed of sound. So the I can only conclude that one geologist had to be looking at the time when the earthquake happened, looked up, saw the formation, had enough time to say, Clumma, this is it. And probably by the time he said it, the thing had hit him and he was killed innocently. But again, it hit Spirit Lake. Spirit Lake formed a pocket of steam. That thing rolled off like a hockey puck. And gave it, that's why it gave it much more distance than you would have thought. If you look at the area of devastation.
It's... So there's a lot of photographs of the eruption in progress, and there's a satellite view that you retweeted mm-hmm. that goes into what happened from space. I mean, it's got got the state line superimposed over the
sure.
This is basically the entire southwest quadrant of Washington State.
It went up to, like, my brother was in Missoula, Montana,
yeah.
and was seeing dust flow. It went up into Canada. I mean, it was a large dust plume.
Yeah.
But I understand that it took the boiling magma chamber, now exposed, several hours to boil. Right? Because what happens at the top of the boiling chamber is the stuff is popping bubbles. And pushing down on the stuff, which is trying to reach the surface, right? And so it takes a little while for the magma chamber that much ash to boil out. But if you look at the ash under a microscope, what you see is bubbles. It looks like it's rock foam, right? And the bubbles brain white was particularly sharp and insidious was that you could see nice curved parts of what was a bubble,
mm-hmm.
and was with jagged edges, right?
Mm.
The pumice that was being generated, right? The liquid pumice being generated, the bubble would freeze, but the gases would pop and crack the bubble. So you had these sort of spherical shards that were very, very sharp. The silicosis, the people that suffered long time afterwards that didn't have gas masks, breathed in micro fine silicon particles.
Mm.
And if you looked at it, if you felt it, it was again like you were, if you rub your hands together, it hurt because of like rubbing sandpaper, right? It was these very, very sharp, micron size fibers. So we know now when you go to places like Kilauea that we have these filters on the thing that are in part to try to keep the fine particles from entering your lungs,
because mm-hmm.
you don't want that stuff. So the earthquake happens, and you can tell, oh, it's a good earthquake, right? And understand, you know, I live in earthquake country, and I have learned to enjoy earthquakes when they happen, right? Not the fear and freak out, but to pay attention, right?
Mm.
So when an earthquake happens, I pay attention, and I try to distinguish between the P wave, and the S wave, whoosh, 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 back and forth. And you take the time between the P wave and the S wave, and for every second, it's 8 kilometers or 5 miles.
Okay.
It's like lightning, thunder, sort of thing.
Sure.
The one moves faster than the other. So you get the wham, right? And that tells you, that duration, the count, tells you how far away the epicenter was. Well, it was pretty much on top. Wham, right? And of course, but unlike a normal earthquake where you get round, you go right, 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 this kept going and going, 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 right? The other thing was the sound. And this is the thing that is you have to have been there. The pictures are dramatic, but the sound of volcanoes, actually erupting volcanoes, are just incredible. And now we know from Kilauea, we have sound meter. We can tell some of the stuff like what was happening, where you had things around, you know, Kilauea has these lava tubes that resonate around 8 hertz and so forth. It's really, but you get the harmonics. You can hear some of the lower harmonics of these lower sound waves going. But you had a mountain-sized subwoofer going off with a force of like 27 megatons. I mean, we had a tremendous sound thing there. And I remember feeling the sound inside my chest. It felt like that things were, the sound waves were squeezing inside the chest. You get this pressure here. And again, it's from the sound waves, very loud, very intense, ultra subsonic sound waves,
mm-hmm.
that you were experiencing. There were a lot of high level harmonics as well. When because it took several hours for this the major part of the magma chamber to boil away, and so that's where you got nearly a cubic kilometer of ash coming out, because you had this large cubic kilometer of almost probably in size of magma exposed to the surface going whoosh. And that dusting that went all the way up into Canada was from essentially the rock foam, right?
Mm-hmm.
Just like you took a can of Coca-Cola, ripped off the top and had all this foam come out, right? But the foam hardens to these little bubble shards that end up there. Close to the mountain, the bubbles were more intact. As you got farther away in Montana, it became much very, very fine. So people that experienced the very gritty dust versus fine grit, depending on how far the material carried. But for us, we were upwind.
Mm-hmm.
Blast was on the other side, and we were upwind, and so we didn't get the, there was some backwash, but not much. The other thing was that we were in an area where there had been pumice and other things from ancient eruptions. And the ground was shaking, right? You had these high frequency, and the result was these little pumice rocks where they were sort of dancing around on the ground, right? Because the ground was shaking. I mean, in a little tiny thing, minutes, little thing, but enough that the rocks were sort of, everything was kind of rattling a little bit. And it was kind of, that was the thing that was, I remember looking out around the area and seeing little tiny pumice rock kind of bouncing around on the ground. All over everywhere, because the whole place was just
The place was hopping.
it was, and the other thing was that there was this amazing stark contrast between we were there in daylight,
Yeah.
and we could see the plume going up in the stratosphere, and it was day and night, was the other thing, and then as you watched it, you started seeing flashes inside of the ash plume. And if you were careful, then you saw that what was happening was there was lightning that was about halfway up the side of the mountain that was being generated, arcing up into the ash cloud, and sometimes enough that you kind of illuminate the inside of the ash cloud, right? So that it was black, but all of a sudden you get these pulses where the light was flashing. And this was the static electricity being generated from the foam being ejected, from this magma chamber being ripped open, from the mountain imploding, and then the ash exploding, generated a lot of static electricity. And so you had lightning starting from the side of the mountain up into the thing going. And at the times, we got to the point where it was about 2 to 3, strikes a minute. And you'd see, again, not from the top of the clouds down to the ground, but from the ground up into, and the fingers would sort of would arc up into the cloud, or these zapping things. We did another, there was, the people talk about the May 18th, there was another eruption that occurred on June 10th.
That's right. I forgot about that.
Another one in July. And the June 10th one, we kind of knew what the mountain was doing, so we were there more around on the side to see. And I remember on that June 10th, actually, it was probably by the first time we were up there in the north side, it was probably in like May 22nd, 23rd, remember, when the ash had kind of gone away. And I remember seeing things like several of the cars that were burnt out that we flew up and trying to find a spot. And the area where we had been in the cold water area was like, again, the forests were flat. And in fact, the lake had sort of changed shape, and it was also full of logs. I mean, it had blown virgin forest trees out of the roots, and the whole the much of the lake was covered with essentially dead trees. A bunch of people started trying to say, "Hey, free firewood," and started cutting it until they realized that they were cutting into sandpaper, right? These logs were impregnated with sandpaper, and your chainsaw would only go so much before it started just gumming the wood, right? It would just sort of instant grind it to halt. But even then, we went and had gas masks because there was a lot of dust there, and you didn't want to get dust in the lungs. So we were there for the June eruption and got dust, actually got ash all dusted on us. But again, we were enrolled as safe, and we got out of there. And again, it was confirming. That was also reactor material confirming it was andesitic material that was there. And so barometers around in the area recorded the pulse of this thing through. Other people, farther away recorded it as like cannons going off on a 4th of July parade or something like that, or right here. But up close, it was the subsonic stuff with harmonics that it had that sort of rock concert-like feel of you could feel it in your chest type of thing. You feel it, you felt it in your bones.
Yeah.
That was the thing, and you felt it kind of in your chest,
Oh, yeah.
your cavity, so forth. You heard it, but what you heard was the harmonic overtones,
Right.
the much higher frequency stuff, the low frequency stuff that really was quite there. Now, apart from the original roar, there was some sound you could hear, but it wasn't deafening. It wasn't like a when it after, you know, the a lot of the time afterwards, you can hear the rumbling, but it up close, but it wasn't really deafening. But that initial burst had that feeling. And somebody who had felt and experienced a Saturn V launch and said it was like that,
mm-hmm.
in that event. So, you know, we learned a lot from that event. And we learned a lot about, there's also, but the side of the choir, I think I remember, I have a beef with the news station in Portland. We wanted to, in fact, we had a, you know, advisor was going to go on, he's periodic checking with Mount St. Helens what's happening.
Sure.
And he was all geared to say, you know, after the, because May 18th, I think it was a Sunday, right?
Mm-hmm.
And he was geared to go on the Friday evening show and say, here's the data, here's what's happening. It's extremely dangerous right now. If there's any time to not be there,
it's
now. And the radio station said, well, you know, we have you on to give us the stuff, but we have a different angle in it. We have this psychic.
Oh, no.
And so she is, we're going to consult with her on whether she's had headaches recently. So you can come back next week. and you know, I wondered how many people, because he was going to put up the charts. He was going to put up, you know, have a chart, a picture from the the Mount Lassen blast, and say, this is what's coming. This is the area. This lake isn't going to protect you. You know, stay away. But instead, the psychic. I have no idea whether she actually had a headache at the time of it or not. But that's that Portland station. You know, the thing that's also that is important to realize is that mountains, volcanoes are most dangerous when they implode. They don't go bang like the people think. Well, didn't it? Mount Helens explode? Yes, but most of what happened was it fell in on itself. It blew out the side and fell in on itself. The collapse of volcanoes ends up creating very significant events. Now, Mount St. Helens was certainly one of the largest landslides in recorded history, and one of the most, you know, violent volcanic eruptions in American history. We had certainly violent things that occurred in Kilauea in its 1790 event,
mm-hmm.
Ended up changing the political landscape of Hawaii. We've had other, you know, greater events like that, but it's when volcanoes lose their structure and fall in on itself that they become the big explosion. Krakatoa was the same way. It erupted so much that it fell in on itself and the magma chamber became exposed and went poosh. You know, Tombo, that sort of thing. Those are events where the essentially the mouth of volcano falls in itself. Now, as I say, Mount St. Helens today remains, yes, my top five volcanoes,
yeah.
Peak, Mount St. Helens, Kilauea, Mauna Loa, and Mount Erebus are my five favorite volcanoes I've had the pleasure to experience. But again, if you're safe, if you have protocols, if you have other things, you can collect data. And nowadays, of course, if it was today, we would have sensors sprinkled all over the mountain, and we'd know a lot more than we do now, and we'd not have had people had to be there,
mm-hmm.
to remote cameras and Wi-Fi and all that sort of stuff and cellular stuff would have done a much better job,
right.
Without this lost life. Any other questions you have for Ben?
Oh, probably lots and lots of them. But I'm afraid I really do have to close out. I've got to get to another meeting. But I can't tell you how much I appreciate you giving me the firsthand account, because to me it's riveting. I've just really been looking forward to this conversation. You know.
Well, thank you very much. And I say it. And it was an amazing experience. Part of what makes this universe my favorite universe. And I look forward to other. Safe and sane experiences with volcanoes.
Well, maybe next time we can talk about Kona and Krakatoa and some of the other ones.
Yeah, absolutely.
Cool beans.
Well, thanks again.
Thanks.